Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanifa. In this underlying reason number 5, where we are going to talk about the leadership of women, or people that are ruled by a woman will never see success, or as such is said in a hadith that is reported in Arabic. I will get back to this later on, inshallah. But I'd like to say, in a world that's changed and is still changing these days, where humans are stepping into new territories that they've never been before. Now, you know, operation of the heart, the limbs and eyes, they even have reached a stage where they can transplant a face of a dead person onto that of a live person. And it happened in the United States of America, where a dead person's face was transplanted into somebody who had problems with his face. And then they took the wife of the dead person to meet the other person. And the shock was that she couldn't actually see the difference. She thought her husband was alive. And subhanallah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. And he taught the human that which he didn't know. So all this is from Allah for the benefit of humanity. So the world is ever changing. Women are making big contributions to the world. But subhanallah, one such discovery that the world has reached these days is that women can do far more than they were credited before for what they did. Without going much into details about what women did and what women cannot do and what women's job are and things like that, I want to concentrate on one particular type of a position in work, and that is the leadership of a woman. Can a woman lead a country? Can a woman lead a society, a company, or an organization, or a corporation? Can a woman lead a team of workers? Can actually a woman be a leader? When you ask this question to the scholars of Islam, and I will specifically mention the Salafi people, because not all the scholars agree on this issue. But since Saudi Arabia today has delegated itself as the protector of Islam, as the leader of the Salafism and all that kind of stuff, and as I said it 1,000 times, and I will say it one more time, that what Saudi Arabia preaches is the Hanbali school of thought, and then later on Ibn Taymiyyah's school of thought, renewed by Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, Wahhabism, and today is again repackaged as Salafism. So when I say Salafism, Saudi Arabia, what I really mean is the Hanbali and the Wahhabi school of thought. But since the wealth, Allah has given them that great wealth, and since they have Mecca and Al-Madina, so they're kind of like in a high position where everybody thinks whatever comes from Saudi Arabia must be the authentic truth, when in fact it is far more than that. So, and I will get back to that, inshallah. So if you ask this question around the world, can a woman be a leader? Throughout the world, people will give you different reasons, different answers. But if you went to Saudi Arabia and you asked every single person of the 30 so million of people there, they will all unanimously agree that women are not fit for leadership. And they can't even take responsibility over any affairs. And as soon as you ask them for an evidence, they will always turn into the hadith that we are discussing today, that women are not capable of leadership, and they give you the hadith that I will mention later on. So the question is, how can we convince the world, because Islam, remember the Qur'an, this religion is for mankind, hudan linnas, a guidance to mankind. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we have sent you only as a mercy to all mankind, all the worlds, everything that exists out there. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent for them. So how can we convince that world that Islam came to liberate women? And I'm just, because you're talking about women. So Islam came to liberate women. Only when women enter Islam, they become more restricted. And I give an example. We tell people that Islam is the first religion that gave women the right to inheritance. So a woman can inherit, and it is in Al-Quran, so we cannot cheat. But do you know that as soon as a woman inherits her money, in the understanding of the Hanbali school of thought, the Saudi school of thought, the Wahhabi school of thought, a woman cannot deal with her own money without the permission of her husband. What this means is, my sisters and my brothers, let's say you, my sister, you are married to a man and you inherit £1 million. Now you get it deposited, or $1 million or whatever the currency, and you get that amount deposited in your bank account. Once it is in your bank account, it is yours, but you have no right whatsoever to spend £1 or one penny out of that money without the consent of your husband. So the husband becomes the one who controls that money. Reason being, they say, is because women are not capable of running their own affairs. How can we convince the world that Islam came to liberate women when as soon as they walk into Islam, they become far more restricted than they ever been? What they wear, what they do, what, how they sit, how they look, what to do, everything is so controlled that I really, really, really raise my hat as high as it can get to you ladies out there, Muslim women, who are still Muslims and you are still doing your best to follow the commands of Allah, because it really is so belittling, so demoralizing, so negative that it is unbelievable there. But the whole problem is they brought the understanding of belittling women from the men themselves, the Bedouins of the Arabs since the old days until our times. But not that of an Islam, because Islam never came to belittle any woman whatsoever. Haven't you noticed that the slightest questioning about what some sheikhs say about women, if you try to debate it, if you try to discuss it, you are faced with a torrent of insults and attacks on your persona. Last night I was watching this set on television where a sheikh in the Gulf was asked by a woman. She said to him, "Ya sheikh, we women, we carry the babies for 9 months. We struggle with them. Then when we give them birth, it never is ice cream. It's always pain and it's always screams. And then it is us who wake up at night, take care of the kids, make sure they are fed, make sure they are changed, make sure that everything of their needs are met. And if the baby cries at night, I do not wish to wake my husband. So I take the baby maybe to the kitchen or elsewhere, breastfeed him or breastfeed her, and then change them. And if they don't sleep, stay with them until they sleep. And then I go to sleep. And before my husband wakes up, I wake up in the morning, prepare his breakfast, even though I slept only a couple hours. And my eyes are just like that of a frog because I need to sleep. And then the husband goes out from his house to an office. He sits there. And then I take care of the household and then take care of the baby throughout the day. Make sure the dinner is cooked. And the husband is out there in an office making a call here, working. And then when he comes in the afternoon, he finds his food ready for him to eat, and the baby all cleaned and all nice. And the husband spends maybe 5-10 minutes looking at the baby, but that's all. And then he does what he does, then goes to sleep. And also at night I do that. And then my life is with the kids, and we take care of the children. So much so that we spend more time with the kids, more than the husband. So how can Rasulullah say, if I was to command someone to prostrate to another one, I would have commanded for the wife to prostrate to a husband? And for your information, I swear to Allah, Rasulullah never uttered these hadith. They were man-made, created 300 years later, and they put them on the account of Rasulullah. And as I have said it before, for a sheikh to make up a hadith, they only needed two things. And the scholars were the ones who made up the hadith. It was not the farmers and it was not the musicians. Back in time, it was people, because to make up a hadith back then, you needed a chain of narrators. And two is that you had to have a good grasp of the Arabic language. And both these shuyukh had this thing, so it was very easy for them to make up a chain of narrator, make up a statement, and then link it to Rasulullah. And when the scholars of hadith try to find out if this hadith had a strong chain of narrators, guess what? They find it has a strong chain of narrators. And that's how the hadith is born. So Rasulullah would never ever give an example with something that is not permitted, it's haram, to prostrate to somebody else. That's why Allah made the angels prostrate to our father Adam, because the prostrations is the biggest thing that somebody does to someone else. And the Shaykh got angry, and he goes to work doing what? Is he fighting lions every single day in his life? Is he in danger every single day? Every day he fights 12 lions, meaning like at any one point a lion can eat him? Yes, I would understand that. Is he a gladiator, always in a stadium fighting all these big muscle dudes for days and nights just to bring us some bread? I would understand that. Is he really jumping every day off a plane without parachutes and doing that's his living? He just gets out of the house, gets in the car, goes to work, sits on a desk, farts all day, comes home, and why should he have all these big, huge titles? Why? The Sheikh couldn't answer, so he turned it into an angry attack on the lady. What do you think if you go to him and you tell him about the leadership of women? Especially in the Wahhabi world, in the Salafi world, as soon as you open your mouth, because they are really land and they are really a pair of shoes to the leaders, as soon as you open your mouth for leadership, they will attack you as if you are Satan. So this is why the scholars, they push the hadith and make it like it comes from Allah when it doesn't come from Allah. And as I said once, what's in Al-Quran is Islam. Anything external is explaining what's in the Quran. Al-Bukhari and Muslim are not Islam. They are reports of man. What's in Al-Quran is Al-Islam, because that's the book of Allah. And we have got to understand this so that we come out from the problems that we have been facing for the last 14 centuries. You always have been brought up to think that if you reject anything that Rasulullah, you become an apostate, you become a kafir. When in fact that is absolutely untrue. You have every right that when a hadith comes to you, when a scholar comes to you, when someone comes to you, that whatever it is that they're telling you is fishy, you've got every right to reject it. Yes, you can't reject Al-Quran, but you can reject the understanding of somebody of what they understood from the Quran. You can't say, I don't take Alhamdulillah, because that's part of Al-Quran. But if someone says to you, oh, Alhamdulillah means you be thankful to Allah. And I will tell him, excuse me, your understanding is absolutely rubbish. Alhamdulillah doesn't mean thank you, Ya Allah. Alhamdulillah means something else, and then I explained. So I've rejected their understanding. I didn't reject the Quran. But when it comes to a hadith, I can full-heartedly say, no, that hadith doesn't make sense with me. And as I have already pointed out, few hadith that do not make sense. I'm not the only one. Scholars of Islam have rejected many of these hadith, but they are kept hidden from you because they serve the purpose of the men of religion, and they serve the purpose of the people of the government, the kings and things like that, just like this hadith here. My dear sisters and my brothers, Allah says in Al-Quran about this book here, he goes, "Inna hadha al-Quran." It certainly is that this Quran here that you've got in your hands, yahdi lillati hiya aqwa, guides to the straightest, i.e. whatever you want to do in your life, check it out in the Quran will lead you to the straightest of that matter. وَيُبَشِّرْ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, and it brings good news for the believers. Today, the Muslims, we do not truly believe that the Quran has the best solution. We always are surrounded by a hadith. And you will see in this topic here that I'm covering how that is the case. But in our days, my dear sisters and my brothers, when the man of religion report a hadith, they make it as the guide and the straightest guide ever. And here is one of such a hadith. The hadith is reported by Abu Bakrata. There is a companion called Abu Bakrata, who says, لَمَّا بَلَغَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ when the news reached Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أن أهل فارس قد ملكوا عليهم بنت كسرى, that the people of Fars, Persia at that time, is Iran today, they have queened or kinged a girl over them. They made her queen, so she controls the whole country. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it's reported, or it's allegedly reported, him saying, لن يفلح قوم ولو أمرهم امرأة, no people shall succeed who elect a woman as their leader. This hadith is reported in Al-Bukhari, Al-Nasa'i, and even Al-Imam Al-Nasa'i, Allah have mercy on his soul, he documented this statement here in his book, where he said that prohibition to using women in power. So he made it prohibition. Let me tell you the story of how this hadith got to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You remember when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent messages to different kings, right? To Egypt, to Yemen, to Kisra, to the Romans, and all these things. Well, he happened to have sent someone to Kisra. Kisra today, which is in Iran, all these things. But this king here, what he did, he tore the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam into pieces, and he killed the messenger. So when he did that, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a dua against him, and he said, may Allah tear his kingdom apart, just like he tore my message and he killed my messengers, my messenger. Later, this king here's name was Bahram Jur, and he was the son of another king called Yazdajard. When Yazdajard, the king, died, he died killed by his own son. But it so happened when this king here, before he was assassinated, Yazdajard, he had made a beautiful bottle, and in that bottle, he put a very strong poison, and he called that poison elixir of life, by whatever purpose he did. So when his son killed his father, later on, the kid, the son, went into his father's affairs, looking, you know, looking for gold, looking for all these things, and he found the bottle, and it had elixir of life. So the kid thought that his dad had a special potion where if you drink it, you will have like a prolonged life or something better. So he drank from that bottle, from that strong poison, and that killed the son. And the Arabs also coined after that incident happened, they say, Al-Maqtul Alladhi Qatala Qatila, the assassinated who killed his murderer. So even after his death, he managed to kill his son. After the death of the son, the next in throne was the girl. And that is the girl that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have spoken about, that her people will not succeed because they have appointed her as a leader. Now that we have seen the historical event, how it took place, now let us look at the hadith itself. The hadith, you're going to deal with the wordings. And this hadith has been reported in three different versions. And these are the authentic ones. There are other versions that are weak, so they were disregarded by the scholars of hadith. And I will do the same thing. I'm not going to speak about them, but I will discuss the three hadith, the three ones that are authentically reported between the scholars. And I will say them to you, and I will deal with them. The very first one is, لن يفلح قوم. The whole hadith is the same, is except when it comes to the position of woman that has changed. So لن يفلح قوم, a people won't succeed, ولو أمرهم امرأة, they appointed a woman as a manager of their affairs. So Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم in this hadith here is reported to have said that these people will not succeed. The second hadith, لن يفلح قوم, again, a people won't succeed who are queened by a woman, i.e. the woman is their queen, like the Queen Elizabeth of England. So these people here will not succeed. And the third hadith, لن يفلح قوم, a people won't succeed, أسندوا أمرهم إلى امرأة, they delegated their affairs to a woman. So the very first hadith is they appointed a woman as the state of the head of their affairs. The second one is she is the queen, she owns the people. And the third one, they delegated their affairs to a woman. The question here, this hadith is reported in Al-Bukhari, Al-Tirmidhi, Al-Nasa'i, and Ahmad, and it is an authentic one. Okay, it's very sahih. Now, my question is, which of the above three statements has the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam truly spoken? Appointed a woman, queened by a woman, or delegated their affairs to a woman? Which of these three words has Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or these three hadiths, has Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spoken? And in which case here, there is one that is true and the two others aren't. But our scholars, they base everything on the three. Either he said it or he didn't say it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because in one word, the dangers that are today amongst us are unbelievable because of one statement. And I will get back to this, inshallah, later on. So someone might say, why ask for what exactly came out from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Take the general meaning and that should be enough. And this is, my dear sisters and my brothers, what the scholars of Islam have done when it came to this hadith. They took the general meaning of that hadith and they lived with it. And they said that is what Islam is all about. So they combined the whole three hadith. But the problem is, my dear sisters, let me give you an example, a real example of today, so that you understand where I am coming from. Let's say you apply for a job in IBM or some big corporation. Okay, and you go for an interview and someone comes to you, who the interviewer comes to you, and they introduce themselves and they will tell you, I am given authority over this company. And then he would say later on in the conversation, I am the owner of this company. And then along the conversation he says, I am delegated the affairs of this company. My question is, what is this person's position in that company? The first one, he is the authorized person that deals with this company. The other one, he is the owner of the company. And the third one, he's only delegated the affairs of this company. So what is the position of this person? I leave it to you. If we can't come up with a position and we will differ about that, why is the hadith any different? We have three hadith that says three different things. So women here are the poor guys in the whole thing. And also let us look at this hadith from the narrator himself and look out at what came from that. The chief narrator of this alleged hadith is a man known as Abu Bakr, and he is a companion, as I said, who claims to have heard Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam say that this hadith, that a people will not succeed if owned, delegated, authorized by a woman. The question to ask is, was this companion the only one who heard Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Which is the case. And for your information, when the hadith is ahad, i.e. by unity, that one singular form is coming to us, we are absolutely in freedom to use it or disregard it altogether. It's no problem at all in this matter here. So you can straightway turn and say, all these hadiths to me, they are ahad, they are singular form, I don't care about them, and you'll be right. But anyhow, is this companion here the only one who heard this hadith here? Were there others with him? And if there were others with him who heard this hadith, especially the messengers who came and brought the news and all that kind of stuff, why didn't they report the hadith and share it widely with the other people of Al-Madinah? Or did they understood from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he said what he said, that it was not a divine law, but it was more of a remark of something like that? Okay, it's like, for example, I'll give you an example. Say you are a good driver and you know XYZ, one of your friends is the worst driver that could be there. And then you hear that the father of that worst driver gave him a Mercedes. And then you tell him, that car there will never ever see the light if driven by that person. Have you made a remark or have you issued a statement that that car there will never be the safe and it's gonna just become a wreck? You've just made a comment about a situation. So if a group of the Sahaba have listened to this from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they didn't report it to other people, including Abu Bakr, because when we will see when he said that hadith, he will understand that at the beginning it was just a comment by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if ever he uttered it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because I do not believe that he uttered it as a ruling. Anyway, so now we know that there is an if. Let's also take a look at the when this hadith was made. How did it come to life? Not when al-Bukhari documented 300 years later. I'm saying about when the scholar said that the Abu Bakrata, the narrator of the hadith, reported this hadith. The reason behind the saying of this hadith, my dear sisters and my brother, again, we're going back to the murdering of Uthman, the third Khalifa, Allah have mercy on his soul. And then, you know, the tribulations that took place, and then Ali was forced into the leadership, and then he became the fourth Amir al-Mu'minin, the fourth leaders of the believers. But not all people were happy with the appointment of Ali, because as soon as Uthman was killed, one of the early people that demanded for his blood vengeance was our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, Talha ibn Ubaidillah, and Az-Zubair ibn al-Awwam. These three people, they led a coalition with Muawiyah against the killers of Uthman. And these four, Talha, Zubair, and our mother Aisha, and Muawiyah, they were one front opposing the killers of Uthman, who later on appointed Ali. So the four of them, Talha, Zubair, Aisha, and Muawiyah, became the opponent of Ali radiallahu anhu. And then slowly battles started issuing between the two of them, until on the 3rd of November in the year 1656 of the Christian era, and I'm talking here about 1,362 years ago, when a huge battle took place and is widely known as Ma'rakatul Jamal, the Battle of the Camel. This Battle of the Camel took place in the year 36 after the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We take 10 years, because you know, when they started the calendar, they started from the migration, and our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died in year 10. So it is 26 years after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or 36 years after the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But as far as we are concerned, it is 1,362 years ago that a huge battle took place between our mother Aisha, Talha, Az-Zubayr, and also behind the scene Muawiyah, against the armies of Ali radiallahu anhu. The army led by our mother Aisha, Talha, and Az-Zubayr had 30,000 strong fighters. But Ali radiallahu anhu had 20,000 fighters. The battle took place in Al-Basra in Iraq today. When the battle ended, and the victory was with Ali radiallahu anhu, who lost 5,000 fighters, while the army of our mother Aisha lost 13,000 fighters, strong fighters. So on that day in the battle of the Camel or Al-Jamal, 18,000 people lost their lives. Of these people also was Talha ibn Ubaidillah and Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Allah have mercy on all of them. Then our mother Aisha was captured and taken to Al-Madinah. For your information, and this what I'm going to tell you is not in the books of the Shia, and I am not a Shia, never been a Shia, not even for a single second. But it is in Al-Bukhari, in Muslim, in the books of Siyar A'lam al-Nubala of Al-Imam al-Dhahabi, in the books of history of Imam Ibn Kathir, the beginning and the end, the Bidayah wa Nihaya. It is in the book of history of Ibn al-Athir. It is in the books of the history of At-Tabari. And the books are countless that speak about what I am going to say now. Our mother Aisha never ever liked Ali. Even when she was married to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Ali was the cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, our mother Aisha never ever liked Ali. She hated him so much that she wouldn't even say his name. Also, my dear sisters and my brothers, I'm telling you this for historical facts, okay? No, nothing else. And you will also understand why the scholars of the Sunni world, our scholars, hide history from us, because there are certain things like this that will make your brain boil. Our mother Aisha, the wife of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, hates the daughter of Rasulullah, Fatima. That's why you never find a hadith reported between Aisha and Fatima. Maybe one when Aisha wanted something of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam refused. Aisha tried to use Fatima. But after that, you won't find hadith or that they were loving with each other, nothing at all. Our mother Aisha, Allah forgive her, didn't like the household of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. This is why she had saved a place to be buried with her husband, her father and Umar. She had kept a fourth place for her. Later on, when she was taken in Al-Madinah, when she grew old, when they asked her, where do you want to be buried? And she had saved a place in her own house to be buried by the side of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. She said, I have done a lot of wrong and I do not deserve to be in the same room as Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Bury me in Al-Baqi'ah. And she was buried in Al-Baqi'ah, which is the general cemetery in Al-Madinah. If you've been to Al-Madinah, it's the cemetery where the Sahaba are buried today. And she was buried there because she acknowledged and she deliberately said that I have done a lot of wrong. Allah have mercy on her and on all those people that were involved then. When people were taking sides, which side they would go to the army, fight with Aisha or with Ali? People were taking two sides. It is at that time where Abu Bakr suddenly remembered that 25 years ago, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, or more, maybe 30, because he's at the beginning of Al-Madinah, about 30 years ago, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had already spoken that people led by a woman will never succeed. And guess who that woman was at that day? It was Aisha. So he refused to join the army alone. And he left. He didn't join in the battle. The question to ask is, if he knew that Aisha's army was going to lose for sure, why didn't he save lives and started telling people that he heard Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam say this hadith, and that since our mother Aisha is the leader of the other army, that her defeat was sure? Why did he leave 18,000 people die? What's the thinking behind that? It's really strange. But however, now that we look about the whole history of the thing, now comes the historical and political matters. What truly happened then is after the battle happened and our mother Aisha lost and things like that, when Muawiyah took control, things were still boiling. Problems were still happening. And as I said before, people, there are a lot of things that we do today that were politically motivated. And I will give you one example. Before, people used to, in the masjid, they didn't have carpets like we do today. And they wouldn't have dust, because when it rained, it would make mud. So what they did was have pebbles in the masjid. So lots of masjids, or the majority of the masjid, had pebbles, which was very easy for people. But what it was that when the khatib, the imam, gives the khutbah, and back then it was the leader. So let's say Basra had the governor. It was the governor who gives the khutbah. Baghdad had the governor. It was the leader, the governor of Baghdad, that would give the khutbah. Muawiyah was the leader of Damascus. It was him who would give the khutbah, as you see. Not like today we have the imams employed by the government. They receive their khutbah, their money, and they come sing to us on the minbar. No, before it was the leaders that would give khutbah. And it was a normal practice back then, in those years of turmoils, that when a leader gave a khutbah and people disagreed, they did two things. One of them is throw pebbles at the person who was given khutbah. And they would boo him, boo, and they would respond and tell him, no, what you say is wrong, it's not that. So it was a common practice to hasaba, is when you take a pebble and you pebble someone with that pebble. And this was on Jumas, and it went for the tens of years. Until one day Muawiyah went to Al-Iraq today, and he gave a khutbah, he stood up to give a khutbah. As he started, people started pebbling him, And one of the people threw a pebble at Muawiyah, and Muawiyah picked on that one there, and they arrested him. And then he went ahead and cut off his hand. And then he paid him blood money for his hand, or hand money, so to speak. And then his advisor, they say, "Why did you do that? People are going to revolt." He goes, "This way, no one ever is going to throw pebbles at me." Now they have learned a lesson. They go, "If you go like this, you're going to cut off a lot of hands." And then they devised something, and those ahadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man massa al-hasa faqad lagha," whoever touches a pebble, he has wasted his Jummah. And if you tell someone who sits in front of you, "Listen," then you have wasted your Jummah and there is no reward. Now the thing is, if you tell someone to do good and you lose your khutbah, if the imam speaks, you cannot cut him, because you lose your khutbah. And it became a religion for us, when in fact it was a light hadith that the people have devised, so that when the governors of Banu Umayyah gave a khutbah, no one talked. And it worked. For the next 90 years, Banu Umayyah used to give the khutbah of Jummah from Dhuhr till Maghrib. Asr, they wouldn't pray it, because they had received fatwa from the scholars of that time that told them, as long as you are giving a khutbah, you are in a salat, you are praying. So it became a religion of Islam, and people would sit in the masjid, they can't throw pebbles at the person, they can't argue with the khatib, and the governors of Banu Umayyah would curse Ali every Jumu'ah, and no one could tell them anything, because if you open your mouth, you lose your khutbah. So now you understand, when our mother Aisha radiallahu anha lost the battle and 18,000 people died, later on, in my belief, Abu Hanif, and there are few people who would say it, that have said it, and they are saying it, and it's written by doctorates and scholars, they say this hadith, if, because there is an iffy thing here, it has been made up so that no one ever would do the same thing that our mother Aisha did. And if another woman, for example, the mother of Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Asma, the daughter of Abu Bakr, who will later on encourage her son to fight against al-Hajjaj, if any woman would try to raise an army against the people of Muawiyah or any governor, people have a hadith, an already packed up hadith, that those people are going to a doom, because no people will be succeed if led by a woman. So any woman who would do anything, it's not gonna win. And guess what? It worked. No other women after that ever did anything. Until comes, fast forward to our times, when the Saudi people and other scholars really abused women. They made them not capable of running anything. This is why a woman, forget all these flashy things and the tables you see in the street where they say calling people to Islam, the right of women in Islam. Wallahi, I swear. It's only a flashy propaganda marketing technique to bring people to Islam. Because in Islam, in our fiqh, here is the status of a woman. When a woman gets married, from the day she gets married until she dies, she is at a disadvantage, even when the moment the marriage is taking place. Because when I married my daughter, and I hated it, but I had a respectable sheikh, one of my sheikhs here in London, Abu Fadl, so I, to honor him, but I hated what he did. I had to say to the man who came asking for the daughter of my hand, so it should be him asking me. And then my daughter, she would say, "Yes, my dad, I accept to marry this man." And they reversed the whole process, and it's always reversed. It turned out to be me who offer my daughter to him, and him accepting my daughter. This is crazy. This is in Islam how it goes. You don't ask for the hand. Yes, you go and ask for that, blah, blah, blah. When the time comes in to get married, it is reversed. The father offers his daughter to the groom, and the groom accepts to marry the daughter, because that's how they look at her. She is offered to him. And the woman in Islam, in our fiqh, is not, even the act of marriage is called an act of tamattu, of enjoyment. The marriage is an act of enjoyment. and that is sexual enjoyment. That's what a woman is for in our beautiful religion, what they have turned her to be. Not what Islam says. Allah treats a woman 50-50 like a man, just like man can do certain things women cannot or have difficulties doing. Women can do things that men have difficulties doing, and they are better at them. Allah has given us 50-50. In Islam, we don't marry for love. In Islam, we marry because we look for someone who can perform salat, and that's that. That's why we have trouble in our maritals today. Hardly ever in my 30 years or more in dealing with couples, in dealing in Islam, in talking, in giving khutbah, and interacting with people, hardly ever I've found a Muslim couple that married because they fell in love. The Hollywood love. When you see your partner, your heart kind of like, to us, she's single, he's single. And then he goes and asks, and then they have that infatuation, sexual infatuation, have a couple babies, end of it, no more. And then the man starts looking for a second wife, and the woman starts thinking what to do with my life when the man gets a second or third or fourth wife. So you see, can you see the problem? Later on, that hadith became like a stop sign in front of women, that you women are completely worthless people that can't rule, use, or lead, or be managers, or anything. Aren't you, don't you lack in your mind? Aren't you weak? Aren't you emotional creatures? And women in Islam became nothing but a production of babies. Just like when you go and make a milkshake, you put everything in the blender, so the blender is just to make milkshake. The women in Islam, as considered in our fiqh and by the Salafi and all these creeps, woman is only to make babies. And even by making babies, she still has to prostrate, or hypothetically, to her husband. And this is absolutely nonsense. This is not the Islam, the beautiful Islam that Allah has equaled between man and women in His book, and in His and their actions, and in the reward. When a man and a woman do something, both of them are equally rewarded in the same way. Allah does not differentiate. Oh, it's a female, let me give her half of what the man deserves. Absolutely not, my dear brothers and my sisters. The reward, Allah rewards in the same system. Now, let me give you another idea. Also, then you will understand why it's so political, this hadith. The woman, well, you know the woman, the Persian girl who took control of the Persians, where Rasulullah is allegedly, or they say he said, I don't believe he said, that's why I have trouble with this hadith. Let's say allegedly he said that women will not succeed who are ruled by a woman, and he was talking about a particular woman. When Rasulullah said this, he was alive. But later on when he died and that girl kept ruling Persia, later on, Umar ibn al-Khattab in al-Qadisiyah, they had a fight with the Persians, and they lost, the Persians lost the war. And that girl, that queen, got captured. She got captured, and she was brought to al-Madinah. So now we have that girl who led her people to misery, is captured. Guess who married her? Al-Husayn, the son of Ali, the daughter of Yazdajar, became the wife of Al-Husayn. Ali is very much hated by Banu Umayyah. Al-Hasan, and he was killed, Ali rahmatullah. Al-Hasan, hated by Banu Umayyah, and he died poisoned. Al-Husayn, hated by Banu Umayyah, and he was murdered savagely with about 70 people of his household, including this girl. They were all murdered. Guess what? To attack Ali, they insulted and they did. Al-Hassan, they attacked him, and now came Al-Hussein, who came headlong against the government, the ruling government, because it was who takes the power. Al-Hussein, Ali rahmatullah, radiallahu anhu, had the belief that he could carry on the message of his grandfather, Ali rahmatullah, and return al-Islam to how it was. Banu Umayyah hated that, and of course they said everything evil about Al-Hussein. And what do you think they also said? Well, guess what? His wife is the losing leader that brought down the entire Persian superpower. And as such, Al-Hussein is evil, and even his wife is evil, and his progeny is evil. And now you see where politics are playing a huge role. There were professional people before that made up tons of lies to just hate the household of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it is unbelievable, my dear sisters and my brothers. So now you understand the whole thing. Women, you've got every right to be president. Kings, Allah in the Quran has spoken about the queen of Sheba, Malikat Saba, who went to Sulaiman, and she had made wise decisions, and Allah supported her decisions, and she went to Sulaiman, and she saved her people from being murdered, and she did great deed of goodness, and Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala praised her in Al-Quran. Allah praised Asiya, the wife of Fir'aun, for her good attitude and good behavior. And as you know, Fir'aun was about to kill Musa if his wife didn't intervene. So she was the source of the liberation of the children of Israel from the grip of Fir'aun. She was not murdered when Allah drowned Fir'aun. And Allah praised her in Al-Quran. And Allah at the same time cursed the wife of a prophet, Lot alayhi salam, because she joined her people in the evil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my dear sisters and my brothers in Al-Islam, has praised women, has given abilities, capacities, capabilities to achieve a lot, to really achieve a lot. When the scholars of the Salafi today in Saudi Arabia, and I had discussion personally with these people, and once it was in Mecca, and a few times in seminars when they put down women and I defend, and he said, women, I said to him, who protects the throne of the Al Saud, the family of Saud? Isn't it England? And England is ruled by a woman. How is England losing? How is England never saw a success when the queen is the lady who rules? She is the queen. Margaret Thatcher, Theresa May. Go around the world. You see great women, great politicians. Not only that. And also always remember, the Salafi, the Wahhabi, the Saudis, they have an extreme sensitivity when it comes to ruling. They almost worship the ruler. That's why they are the way they are. Anything that touches leadership, ruling, they become like venomous pythons. Like they will eat you and bite you and smack you and blow you away. And that is what they want to do. Go around the world, my... Let me give you... HP, it was going to go bust. Who saved it from demise? It was a woman. And I can give you examples upon examples upon examples how women have outperformed. The first woman to fly from the United States to Europe in 24 hours, it was a female, the first flyer, and she left her footprint in history. Which of the scholars of the Salafis have left their footprint? I'm not talking about murders and killings and all the things, but positively in humanity, none. Go look in Israel. How is the state of Israel being established? So many women, Golda Meir and all the a lot of spies, female spies, have worked incessantly to bring Israel to what it is today. What have the male, the man of the Gulf, brought to the world? What has the man, the leaders of the Arab world, made for their people? Are the countries of the Arabs today successful because they are run by a man? They are worse. If a donkey ran the Arab countries today, people would be far better off. How can the crown king of crown prince of Saudi Arabia buys a drawing by Leonardo da Vinci of Jesus, son of Mary? And that is, it's not the true Jesus, it's just what Leonardo da Vinci imagined Jesus to be. And then the crown prince of Saudi Arabia buys that drawing for $450 million. Bill Gates, what do you think bought? Bill Gates bought something of Leonardo da Vinci for $30 million. $30 million US dollars. Compare the two. You know what he bought, Bill Gates? He bought the daily diary of Leonardo da Vinci because he wanted to learn how this person was thinking. Bill Gates is absolutely filthy rich. Could have bought so many things, but Bill Gates for 30 millions buys the diary of Leonardo da Vinci. The Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia buys a drawing of Jesus, son of Mary, what Leonardo da Vinci imagined it, with what? $450 million. Where does that money come from? How can the crown prince say that his people in Saudi Arabia are successful? How can the Wahhabis say that they have had 50 years of intense hammering of people about Islam? People hate them so much that atheism in Saudi Arabia is the leading in the Muslim world. What's going on here? Why belittling women? Why making women half a brain? Why making women stupid? What's the problem? And I will tell you the problem and end my talk here. The Arabs, before the coming of Islam, they used to believe that women were created from devils, from shayateen. So much so that they used to say women are an evil, but they are a necessary evil. This is in the Arabs before the coming of Islam. The Arabs is what is in their bloodlines. You remember when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, speaks about the children of Israel? He talks to them about thousands of years, about their ancestors, because the genes carry the disease. The Arabs also have a disease. And the people that used to bury the girls, they used to kill their female, is because they believed that women come from shaitan, from devils. And as such, they buried them and do that, but because they are necessary evil to carry the babies, they couldn't kill them. So because they need babies, right? And that is how it happened. When Islam came and it prohibited the killing of the girls, and as I said many times, the Saudis today and the Arabs in the Gulf especially, they couldn't kill women. So what they killed? Emotions, personality, who they are. They demoralized, they actually demolished what a woman stands for. Why? Because in their depth, women are still created from shayateen. You're going to tell me, oh, come on, do people believe this? Well, guess what? There are even a hadith where people, it is said that it is prohibited to sleep where camels lay, where the camels go and sleep. Why? Because camels are created from shayateen. That is a hadith that says this, and it's an authentic hadith, and in Saudi Arabia, they believe in this hadith. They believe that the camels are made of shayateen. It's crazy. This is why, my sisters and my brothers, I tell you, this hadith about leadership, subhanAllah, and these scholars are so blind. They can't see the world around them, how women are contributing to the world, how women are leading, how women... And if you tell me women fornicate, guess what? You don't fornicate with your door. You don't fornicate with a tree. Who do you fornicate with? With a man, with a human being. So the evil is from both ends. Women, yes, they beautify themselves. They look, because that's how Allah has made them, is that they like beauty. But guess what? When women beautify themselves, they don't go talking to men. Who goes and talks to women? We go and talk to women. Who lures women to bed? We do. Seduction. Why is it called seduction? Seduction is because we go, we use our tongue, we become monkeys, and we dance our head just to convince the woman that we are the perfect mate for her. Women are not walking in the street like that. So please, wallahi, these Salafis, I'm so happy in one hand that the Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman is having a strong hammer on them to destroy the extremism, the evil that has plagued us for generations upon generations. 14 centuries man had run the Muslim world and we haven't seen anything good. Subhanallah, there has been a study made, and I end with this, when I was in America, there was a study made by some corporation. Guess what? They found out that in the Muslim world, from Saudi Arabia to Morocco, if governments paid zakat rikaz is the petrol and all the materials they get of the earth, and they sell it to people. If they paid the zakat as Allah wants it, that is the fifth of what they get out of the land and all that kind of stuff, and distributed it on people, every Muslim from Morocco to Saudi Arabia to Yemen to northern part of Turkey, and from that part of the world, every Muslim would have had a villa, a car, lots of money in the bank, beautiful house, and they don't need to work. Where is that money gone? Where is that money gone? So my dear sisters, especially sisters and brothers, if someone comes to you one day and speaks about this hadith, speak to him about the history, or share with them this clip here or this audio here, inshallah, and so that people become really clear about this. Also in the hadith, when they say, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, la yuflihu qawmun, qawmun is a specific people. He didn't say لا يفلح الناس, humanity will not succeed. People. For example, let me take some part, some tribe in somewhere in the world, people are not educated and women are less educated. And if a woman that is less educated becomes the state, the head of the state, then I will make a comment, I will say these people are doomed because this woman is not educated. But that doesn't mean I have issued a ruling on all the world that that woman there is or that nation there is doomed. Wallahi al-Azim, the manipulation in the hadith is so big that we are controlled by the hadith. Al-Quran, the beautiful book of Allah, is thrown on a shelf because they cannot falsify Al-Quran and they cannot misuse Al-Quran. So they made the hadith first, the Quran ninth, and now all the Islam we have is Qala Rasulullah, Qala Rasulullah. We became just like the Jews. Jesus. So let's now, from now on, instead of saying, Ya Allah, we do like the Christians. Say, oh Jesus, why did you do that? We say, oh Muhammad, why did you do that? Let's become like them. A'udhu billah from this baseness. A'udhu billah from this deviance. A'udhu billah from this misguidance. A'udhu billah from this ignorance. Allah is my Lord. As far as I'm concerned, and we will see inshallah when I do the study of hadith, any hadith that you hear from now on, filter it through the Quran and then filter it. Remember, I said, and then filter it through the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if that hadith goes with the Quran, goes with the practice of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I will just look at it. Because if the hadith tells me to do something that the Quran already told me, I don't need that hadith. Anyhow, this I will cover this inshallah later on when I talk about the science of hadith and contradictions. Now, as for the king who married 400 women, 400 wives, and that is Islamically married them. From some of them he made babies, others he did not. And this marriage took place in 60 years because he started getting married as early as 17 years and he died 77 years old. This king is the founder of the third state of the state, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, King Abdul Aziz Al Saud. He married 400 women in 60 years. That is an average of 6.5 women. Well, there's no half, but just because of the math. If you do 6 by 60, you get 380. And if you get 6 by 7, you get 420. So it's like in between them, too. Some of the women, he didn't see their faces. And the reason being, in Saudi Arabia, in the Wahhabi of that times, it was the custom when they married, a woman wouldn't uncover her face for the first 24 hours because she was shy, timid, and honorable, and blah, 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 blah. And some women that Malik, the King Abdul Aziz married, he only married them for 2 hours. For example, let's say he moves from Al-Dar'iyya, which is near Al-Riyadh, back then it was the capital, he would travel to some place. When he gets there, he would send one of his servants to look for the most beautiful girl. And then they would go to the husband and they would ask him for the daughter. Of course, there, at that time there, Al Saud were very mischievous. It's either you give me or I kill you in the name of establishing the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. These realities and truths are documented by the historians, the British historians that used to live there. Nowadays, the Saudis have falsified the documents and instead of 400, they have brought the number up to 60 or something. Excuse? Well, he used to marry to different tribes so that he brought them together to form Saudi Arabia. So if that is the case, why did he betray and murder as many people as you can count for that? Why didn't he just go because he married? Well, the truth of the matter is, this man was a sex addict. There were some girls he would marry them for 2 hours. And that didn't, and he said it himself, some of the women or many women that I married, I don't even know their faces. Because as I said, for the first 24 hours, you don't see the face of a woman. You just see her naked body, but not face. So it's the king Abdul Aziz. And this also gives you an insight into how much they think of women and that women are just sexual tools. That reality still exists today in Saudi Arabia. I end my talk here and I pray to Allah to bless you all, my sisters, help you become the best of who you can be, And bi'idhillah, bring your generations, especially the female, into being self-confident that they are not belittled. Islam never came to put them down. Make them feel from the young age that they shouldn't take any evil from the husbands that they're gonna marry. Help them build their personality. Be strong, be leaders. If your daughter can invent a machine that can teleport us to the moon, do help her. Subhanallah. A woman from Saudi Arabia that has changed the course of history when she invented something, internal surgery in the human body, pretty soon we're not gonna open the human body at all because she has discovered something where you can do it with light. This woman has won so many trophies, so many certificates around the world. People are applauding her. She's changed the face of medical profession and surgeries. In Saudi Arabia, they call her deviated and evil. And why? Because some of them, they say she's not covering her face. And others, they say she's not doing this. And the lady later on, she spat on him and she goes, I take off my hijab. If all this, I've changed the world and is still carrying, because to them, a woman is nothing else but a bunch of meat good to lie down upon, put some babies in her, she carries the baby, and that is that. Women, Allah has made you more precious than what the Wahhabi Salafi make you be. And I pray to Allah to bless you all, help us all become the better of who we can be, and Allah knows more, and He helps us more. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد. If you want to join the group, please do send me a message on 078-76-408735. This is again your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.